Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the COVID-19 committee. The first item on the agenda is the decision, a decision, take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are members content to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private? And if any member disagrees, can they please indicate this in the chat function now? I can see that no member has indicated they disagree, and as such, we are all agreed. I will now turn to agenda item 2, the ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. This morning, we will be taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs, Michael Russell, MSP. This is the first time that the committee will be engaging in a new formal process for COVID-19. As members will be aware, the Scottish Government announced the outcome of the weekly review of restrictions in a ministerial statement to Parliament on Tuesday afternoon. The Scottish Government has subsequently provided Parliament with draft regulations yesterday afternoon, setting out the measures it intends to take in response to this week's review of restrictions. The committee has the opportunity to take evidence and, if it chooses, comment on these proposals at its meeting this morning. The Scottish Government will then lay final regulations that will give effect to the measures proposed in law. Those regulations will formally come to the committee for a debate and vote, usually in approximately 2 weeks' time, as usual. In that regard, the draft regulations being considered under this process by the committee are entitled the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment No. 5 Regulations 2020. Committee is also considering a laid-only instrument entitled the Coronavirus Act 2020 Suspension Adult Social Care Scotland Regulations 2020 SSI 2020/377. Members are advised that this SSI is not subject to parliamentary procedure, and as such, the committee is taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary and officials on this SSI for information only. The Cabinet Secretary is accompanied by Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Rod Finnan, Professional Social Work Advisor, and David Fotheringham, Head of Adult Social Care, the Scottish Government. Can I welcome you all to the meeting, and can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to attend. Again, as you indicate, we're moving into a new level and area of scrutiny, and I'm pleased that we're doing so. My statement will deal with the ministerial statement of the 24th of November, with the Coronavirus Act 2020 Suspension Adult Social Care Scotland Regulations, with the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment No. 5 Regulations, and I shall refer to the No. 3 and No. 4 Regulations as well. And I hope to do so with clarity, despite the fact there are so many bits to be discussed. First of all, let me turn to the ministerial statement. As the committee knows, the allocation of levels to local authorities under the strategic framework is reviewed on a weekly basis, with the outcome of the third review set out by the First Minister on Tuesday in her statement to Parliament. These reviews seek to manage the prevalence of COVID-19 in such a way as to suppress infections to the lowest possible level and keep them there, whilst mitigating the other health, social and economic harms that COVID and the restrictions required to protect us from it can and do cause. They consider a range of data, as well as local knowledge and intelligence on COVID in our different communities, including looking ahead and the capabilities of the NHS to support COVID patients, as well as other winter pressures. As the First Minister said in Parliament on Tuesday, the national picture has seen stabilisation in the number of new cases across the country, with evidence of a decline in projected pressures on NHS capacity. Every local authority is now showing low concern for projected use of hospital and intensive care beds. That is excellent progress. It's vital, however, it's maintained if we are to meet the challenges, the inevitable challenges of the winter season. That, however, does mask some regional variation, and as such, a cautious approach has continued to be taken, reflecting the fact of the fragility of the situation we're facing, and as yet, no sustained evidence that we are changing the course, the overall course of the pandemic. Therefore, the specific outcome of this week's review is that no additional changes to the existing levels were recommended. The next scheduled review will be on the 1st of December, but of course the government reserves the right to bring forward for any one or more local authorities as new regulations as and when the situation demands. Now, we do remain confident that with local authorities allocated to the appropriate level, the measures in place within the levels will impact positively in the course of the pandemic. That, however, may take some time, and of course it will have to take account of the temporary four-nation festive exemptions for meeting other households announced yesterday, and a guidance for that will be published shortly, I believe, later today. The coronavirus suspension regulations I'll come to in a moment, but let me just say, in terms of the number 3 and 4 regulations, as the announcements last week, the regulations placed a number of areas of Scotland into level 4 as a result of continued worrying data and trends. It is the government's intention for these tougher measures to last until the 11th of December, but we continue to review all areas of Scotland on a weekly basis. These regulations also move an area of Scotland down from level 3 to level 2. That area is East Lothian. I hope that this change does send a message to everyone in Scotland that it is possible to move down a level if we continue to pull together and stick by the restrictions and guidance. Unfortunately, the position in Mid Lothian has not been so positive. Since the last review, there's been a concerning rise in both cases by 50% and test positivity. As a precaution, and taking into account the clinical and public health advice, the Cabinet took the decision that it would not be appropriate to move Mid Lothian to level 2 at this point in time, and it will therefore remain at level 3. This will continue to be reviewed as part of the weekly process. Will engage closely with the local authority on their plans to reverse the increase. Now, the regulations also put travel restrictions into law. These restrictions prohibit individuals from entering or leaving a local authority area that is in level 3 or 4 unless they have a reasonable excuse. These restrictions are important to ensure we limit transmission from one area to another as much as possible. And I'm pleased to report that initial indications over the weekend showed that these regulations were being rigorously observed. On the Amendment No. 5 regulations, yesterday the Scottish Government provided the committee with draft regulations, which we intend to make and lay later today. I look forward to the views of the committee of these. They ensure that students are able to leave their current place of residence at the end of term and return to a family home or other place of residence over the break. And these regulations will come into effect tomorrow, on Friday the 27th of November. Finally, convener, on the Coronavirus Act 2020 Suspension Adult Social Care Scotland regulations, contextually, I should point out that the next reporting period under the Act ends on Monday, and we will be bringing forward a report within the statutory required fortnight, 12 days, I think the statutory requirement is, bringing that forward in a fortnight's time. Sections 16 and 17 of the Coronavirus Act 2020 allow local authorities to dispense with particular social care assessment duties where it would not be practical to comply with them, or to do so would cause unnecessary delay in providing community care services to any person. The provision covers social care for adults and children and support for carers. It's intended to allow local authorities to provide urgent care without delay. During my statement on the third report to Parliament, I announced our plan for secondary legislation to suspend the use of these powers in respect of adult services, while continuing to enable local authorities the option to use them in respect of children's services. These regulations, which were laid in Parliament on the 16th of November, partially suspend the operation of Section 16 of the Coronavirus Act 2020, insofar as it relates to adult social care and adult carers. The partial suspension of Section 16 of the 2020 Act means that the suspended provisions no longer have effect in Scotland, but are capable of being brought back into effect through further regulations should our response to the pandemic require it. This order will mean that the suspension comes into effect on Monday, on the 30th of November. Now, this regulation, as you've said, is classed as laid, no procedure, but of course I'm happy to answer inquiries and questions on it, and I'm sure the Chief Social Work Advisor will be more than happy to do that too. I'm sorry that was slightly lengthy, convener, but I think it lays out what we have to consider today.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and it was useful. And I think also referring to the regulations by their number is perhaps the easiest way to avoid confusion. Can I ask a question about the changes to the adult and adult carers provisions? Clearly, we are seeing a second wave of infections. Could I need some clarification as to why these particular regulations are being switched off or suspended at this time in light of that sort of rise or steady sort of level of transmission of the virus? And please feel free to bring your officials in on this question.
Yeah, I do think that this is a question that officials should address, but let me say, and Rod, I think, probably would want to be the person who does so, though maybe David Fotheringham would also do so. I shall leave it to them to decide who is most appropriate. But from my perspective, I made a commitment at the very start of this process, and it seems an enormously long time ago now, that when regulations were not required, and when we felt these should not be on the statute book, we would either remove them or suspend them. And we're trying to be honest to that. And we undertake a process at every reporting period, we're going through it at the present moment, of looking critically at all the provisions that exist and to say, do we need these? Should these still be here? Now, it's a fine judgment sometimes whether they might still be used. But on this occasion, the view was that it was better not to have them on the statute book because they are exceptional. I mean, I think Monica Lennon has drawn the committee's attention to that on several occasions. They are exceptional, and we shouldn't want to have them there if we cannot have them there. So that is a commitment we made. That's a commitment we're honouring. But I think it's an indication of our caution that they're not being thrown in the bin, but they are being put in the drawer. And I think that is the right thing to do at this stage. But perhaps David or Rod would like to add to that from their professional perspective.
David.
Yeah. Hello. Yes, I mean, just to be clear, the powers are being retained in respect of children's services. When ministers looked at this, they felt there was a concern for the increased demand in children's services to sort of feed through over the winter. So they are being retained for children's services, and Rod could probably comment a bit more about that. But there was the feeling, as the Cabinet Secretary said, that we have made this commitment that the powers would only be in place for the minimum time possible. Has been some progress made. There's relatively few authorities using them, only four authorities using them in the last couple of monitoring periods. So we felt at this point it was appropriate to suspend them in respect of adult services. As the Cabinet Secretary said, we'll continue to monitor the situation and make sure that the powers are available for the minimum time possible. And it is a balance between the understandable desire of carers organisations, human rights organisations, that people enjoy the full process of social care assessment that they would normally do, balancing that against the needs of social workers to move quickly in an emergency sort of pandemic situation. So those are the finely balanced judgments that are being made.
Thank you. And Rod Finnan?
Yes, I just wanted to add from a children's services perspective that there is an anticipated surge. We've been speaking to chief social work officers through Social Work Scotland. There is an anticipated surge in demand for children's services during the winter period, and we want to ensure that services can be provided to children and families who require them as quickly as possible, hence the retention of the powers for children's services, although we will keep that under review as well, because as David has said, the only four local authorities have used the powers. That goes for the children's services powers also. Thanks.
Thank you for that. If I can, I'd like to move on to the travel restrictions. I think this is the first opportunity the committee has since the actual regulations were published to ask questions about that. And my first question on this is one about policing and enforcement. Given the large number of local authorities, the plethora of different levels that apply, can you just help the committee in terms of how the government is ensuring a uniformity of policing and application of these restrictions?
Well, the regulations are, I hope, as clear as they can be made. And the police have indicated, as they always do, that their attempt will be first of all, to use the four E's, but certainly to explain them to people, to encourage people to observe them, and only in extremists to enforce them in the way that they can. But the regulations provide the conformity. And I am encouraged by what I've heard. Now, I don't have the first set of figures yet for that weekend, but in the discussions I've had about in my own area and in reports I've had elsewhere, does appear to be an understanding that travelling from one area to another is one of the ways in which the virus spreads and there is an increase in infection. And by not travelling, you can reduce that the risk not only in your own area, but in other areas as well. Just as there is, and I'm sure Jason Leach would want to say a word or two about this, just as there is a bleed-over effect when infection is rising that goes from one area into a neighbouring area, so we hope there will be a reduction effect so that when it is falling in one area, in the neighbouring area, it will also fall. And it is that travel is a key issue in there. And making sure that that travel is properly policed and that the regulations are clear is the way to do so. And the uniformity lies, you know, and you know, I absolutely don't have to tell you this as an advocate. The universality applies in the application of the law in a even-handed and regular way across the whole country, and that is what is being done. And it's not actually that difficult. You know, movement is restricted. You shouldn't move out of your own local authority area in tiers 3 and 4, and you shouldn't move into those areas except for a reason, a number of exemptions, examples of which are given in the regulations. And certainly I provide that to people who inquire to me, make sure that they understand all those exemptions. And they're quite clear. You know, they deal with issues such as extended families. They deal with key workers. And they can, you know, be explained. I think they also are proportionate, and I hope they are compassionate, as we saw, for example, with the case that was raised with the First Minister last week. Perhaps Jason would like to say a word or two more about them.
It's something we've said before here, Convener. Thank you again for having me this morning. Mr. Russell has covered it very well. From a public health advice perspective, travel is a crucial element of our response. It has to be. Whether that's, as I've used the analogy before, whether you're coming from a Greek island or Elgin, you have to have some level of advice and perhaps some level of lawful restriction to ensure low prevalence doesn't enter high prevalence and high prevalence doesn't enter low prevalence. The same principle applies if you have an outbreak in a meat factory as it applies if you have a large community transmission area, such as we presently have in the west of Scotland. The public health principle is the same. The decision-making about how you then do that and whether you enforce or not is a matter for others, but I am very clear that we need to advise the public not to travel between those areas. There are 4 active levels in Scotland just now. There is nobody in level 0, and I think the advice is pretty clear. That if you are in a 3 or a 4, you shouldn't travel outside. And if you're in a 1 or a 2, you shouldn't travel to a 3 or a 4.
Thank you for that. My final question is a specific one, and it's about an issue that arises across the border that's been highlighted by colleagues. And it's this. In parts of Berwickshire in the Scottish borders, some people's nearest shopping centre is actually over the border, in particular in Berwick itself, which is far in terms of getting food and supplies is far more convenient for people than travelling elsewhere. Can the government reassure people in that situation that by travelling across the border for food and supplies, I think it's permitted in terms of the regulation, that is acceptable?
Well, essential shopping is an exemption, and therefore, you know, if people are undertaking essential shopping, then that exemption would apply. You know, the exemptions are given as example rather than absolutely fixed things, and that's important because there is flexibility and common sense is important here. If somebody is 2 miles from the shop, the essential shop in one direction, 14 miles in the other direction, it makes more sense to go to the 2 miles as long as people recognize it is for essential shopping only, it is not for socializing, all precautions must be taken, and people should recognize that. So wherever you are, you should look at the list of exemptions and ask yourself, do these apply to me? Do these apply to what I am seeking to do? And do I really need to do this? And I just want to stress that final point, because it's going to be very germane when we consider the Christmas issue. Just because there are exemptions, and there have to be exemptions, doesn't mean that you have to use them. If you feel better or safer, or you think it's wiser to do something that doesn't need an exemption, then think about that too. It is the outcome. I mean, I've stressed this, I think, every time I've been a committee convener, it is the outcome that is really important that we're looking for. It is not, the detail of the regulations and the detail of what we're talking about very important, but it is what we're trying to achieve that's even more important, which is to slow down, stop, reverse the spread of this virus and attempt to return Scotland to another state from the state that it is presently in.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Can I now turn for the next questions to Beatrice Wishart?
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'd like to follow on the discussion about travel and specifically around the travel plans for Christmas. The Christmas plan means that people will have the opportunity to travel home, but within a very limited time frame. And there's concern that this is going to present considerable logistic and practical problems for service providers. And I understand the Scottish Government's Plan A is to discourage people from travelling where possible. But can the Cabinet Secretary assure committee members that there's a Plan B? And how will it be ensured that the system doesn't become overwhelmed and that people don't become overwhelmed?
Well, I cannot assure members of that, but I would ask people to take the necessary steps themselves to ensure that that does not happen. You are an MSP for an island constituency. I have a very substantial number of islands in my constituency. I recognise that there will be issues of capacity within the ferry services and the transport services. It is vitally important that people are planning to take advantage of the period between the 23rd and the 27th, inclusive, which is the period in which regulations will be slightly relaxed, that they plan that very well ahead, they book that very well ahead. There are capacity restrictions, as you know, on the ferry service because of social distancing, and they do so. And providing that happens, providing people are sensible about it, there should be enough capacity. But I'm sorry, I cannot guarantee things which are impossible to guarantee, but I can say if people think now, think ahead, decide what they want to do, put that in place. The regulations, I believe, have now been published, the guidance has now been published. It is absolutely clear. But equally, the First Minister stressed yesterday, I stress again today, because these things are possible, does not mean that they should happen. I was reading this morning, for example, that in Germany there is to be a relaxation for a slightly longer period. But again, Mrs. Merkel made it absolutely clear in announcing it that she hoped that many people would not take advantage of. So I think that is really clear. I would get on with it. I would make sure that people make the bookings they need to make, recognize that the travel window is absolute and will not be extended, and therefore act now.
Thank you for the answer. You said the travel period won't be extended. Was there any consideration given for extra days for the islands, for people to get to and from the islands, like those that have been applied in Northern Ireland?
There have been discussions, but it is felt that restricting travel is of such importance and that making sure that this is contained is of such importance that it is clear that those days are the days inclusive and people should work within them. I mean, there has been criticism of even allowing these days, and it is a fine judgment, but it is 23rd to 27th for the whole country.
But can I ask what engagement the government had with travel providers ahead of announcing their plan and how the islands were considered in formulating the rules for the Christmas period?
Well, I can assure you that the islands issues, for example, were discussed at cabinet level. I was there. I represent islands myself. In terms of consultation, I'm not privy to that full information. This was a four countries discussion held by the First Minister and others, but I can assure you that none of these decisions were made without very extensive thought. And indeed, you will yourself have seen the speculation that was rife over the weekend and into the start of this week. There's been a huge focus upon this, and it is not perfect. There are other people who would argue for more. There are some people who would argue for very substantially less or nothing at all. I think this is the compromise position, and I hope it is welcome to everybody.
No, thank you for that. I understand the compromise position, but there is actually a genuine concern about the limitations of the capacity, and that there may be pinch points or bottlenecks around those 2 or 3 days with people trying to get to and from and connect with an overnight ferry service.
We very much recognise that, and that's why we are advising people to make their plans and provisions as early as they possibly can. This is a period of some leeway to allow people to visit friends and family, particularly in extremis, where people have not seen each other for a long period of time. It is not a licence to change the way in which we live our lives for those 5 days. That is really, really important that is understood. There are strong grounds for allowing this period, but it should not be thought of in any other way than that slight lessening to allow something to happen. It is not a change of regulations. It is not saying, whew, that's over, and we must treat it very seriously in that way.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Beatrice. Please, can I turn next to Stuart McMillan?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everyone. Just a couple of questions regarding instrument 377. The first one is just in terms of the length of time that this set of regulations are anticipated to be in place for, please.
Sorry, which regulation? Is it number 3 and number 4?
It's SSI 220-377.
Well, what does it refer to? I have been referring to them as regulations 3 and 4. Perhaps you could enlighten me. I'm just addressing them in that way. What is the subject you wish?
I think Stuart McMillan is referring to the social care.
Fine. That's the suspension of adult social care.
Yes.
Okay, perhaps I could ask David to deal with that. I mean, they are now, as I said, they're in the drawer, but they can be taken out at any time. The effect suspension starts on the 30th of November. I'm not sure it has any limitation to it, but David might indicate that. The power only exists as long as the acts exist. So I suppose the self-limitation is, to be straight, that as long as the acts exist, the power would exist, but the power is in suspension, and we would need to use another instrument to bring it back, is my view. David, am I right, or have I,
yes,
have I
yes,
got that wrong?
That's absolutely. No, that's right. So the suspension is from the 30th of November, but we can bring the powers back as long as the act is in place, but that would require further regulations in order to do so.
No, thank you. Earlier, Mr. Finnan had indicated that there had been engagement with social work on this particular instrument. Did the local authorities specifically ask for these set of regulations to be implemented, or was it just something that, as a consequence of that engagement, that it was decided by the government to introduce these regulations?
Well, the regulation was part of the Coronavirus Act 2020, and it was brought in, if you remember correctly, because there was a view that the administration of these issues within local authorities might be overwhelmed, and it might not be possible to operate according to the regular legislation. That's why they were brought in. Now, I think there's so much of this, but let me just stretch from my memory what I can. I seem to remember that Monica Lennon raised a question about this very early on, in fact, during the passage of the bill. And then in the first reporting session, which would have been the reporting session in the end of May, there was a question about how many local authorities had used this. I don't think we were entirely clear then. I think we then got some clarity that had very limited use. And I think the view then was that if it had very limited use, maybe it was not going to be necessary to keep it on the statute book. I think in the second reporting period, that was where we were, and now it has now come essentially off the active statute book. If it had been widely used and local authorities had said they wanted to continue to use it, that would have been an element that would have been taken into account. But that's not the case as far as I'm aware. Now, of course, the children's power remains on the statute book, but the adult power has been removed. And I think David indicated only four local authorities had used it.
Well, that's helpful. I'm very much aware, obviously, regarding the previous legislation. But just in terms of the fact that this set of regulations are to be obviously brought forward and laid obviously in Parliament now, I was just wondering as to whether the genesis actually had been requests from local authorities, or just because of the genuine engagement. Just seeking some clarification, that was all.
Well, I repeat what I said in answer to the convener's, I think, opening question. The view the government has held, which is I've repeated many times in this committee, is that when powers are not required, we should not hold on to them. This sits between the two. We've suspended a number of powers before. We've got rid of a number of powers before. That exercise is going on now for the next period of reporting, and so it will continue. So the request for the power, I think, is jointly between officials and local authorities at the time of the Coronavirus Acts. The desire not to hold things on statute book is a policy commitment that we made in Parliament and which we hold to.
Okay, no, thank you. My final question, just it's regarding the festive period once again, and it's I've had a number of constituents contact me on this. In terms of the current extended households, will they be included in that festive period? So obviously with the set of the Four Nations Agreement that's taking place, with potentially having up to three households over that period of time. Existing extended households, are they in addition, or sorry, are they also included in the potential three, or does it, when we get to the period between 23rd and 27th, it's a new set of three, well, up to three households?
Well, no, I'll ask Jason to be entirely specific about it, but the general point I would want to make, Mr. McMillan, and it's a really important point, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to make it, the regulations that exist continue to exist. We're not waiving the regulations. The regulations exist. There is a loosening of regulations in to do with the number of families and get together and the travel regulations, but how you operate and how you behave, in other words, the definition of it, household and all the rest of it, remains in force. You could just say that this was a slight loosening, as I indicated to Beatrice Wishart, for a very limited period of time. If you live in Scotland, you're bound by the Scottish regulations. But perhaps Jason would like to make the point to explain the extended family.
I'm happy to, but I need to ask you a question just before I do that, Mr. Russell. You said the guidance is published. Before I answer the question, I need to know if the guidance is approved and published.
I understand that it has been published this morning, but I will now seek that confirmation. I understand that it was published this morning.
Great. So in which case I can answer the question. My hesitation, convener, was only I didn't want to preempt final approvals from Cabinet members and the First Minister, not anything about trying to hide those.
I'll clarify that now, just in case. But it is not published at this instant. Imminent, put it that way.
Okay. But, it certainly is imminent, and the First Minister will be making a statement along those lines before First Minister's questions, as you would expect. So I'll stay generic until we hear that, and then if published, I can tell you what the actual answer to that question is, convener, if that's helpful, and if not, you'll only have to wait a couple of hours.
That's fine, but I would say Shona Robertson has kindly and helpfully said that it is published on the website, so I'm sure we'll get there.
In which case I can answer the question very specifically. the Scottish version of three households, and remember, in the negotiations, the four-country agreement is three households, 5 days across all nations, and all of us agreed with that, both from a clinical advice perspective and from a decision-maker political perspective. But there is some flexibility in how you then define that in your own country. So Northern Ireland, for example, has defined the travel as slightly longer, and each country will have its own definitions of what we mean by households. So in Scotland, our guidance to the public, and you can see where this is coming from if you watched the briefing yesterday and the angst the First Minister and I both expressed about this relaxation, is that one extended household will be allowed. So one of the three can be an extended household. So that effectively takes you into a position where the maximum number of different living arrangements could be four. So in amongst your three households, one of them can be in an extended household.
I can confirm it is published, as Shoshana Robertson has given us fully accurate advice, as she always does. And what Jason has said is in the regulations, it says between the 23rd and the 27th of December, you can form a bubble of up to three households, one of which can be an extended household. However, we do recommend that you keep any bubble to a maximum of eight people. Children under the age of 12 from these households need not count towards the total number of people counted in the bubble. You should keep the numbers within a bubble as low as possible and minimise the duration of contact between different households as much as possible. You should not change the members in your bubble once it has been formed. If anyone in the bubble contracts COVID-19, all members of the bubble will be required to isolate for 14 days. So that is up-to-date advice.
No, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I turn next, please, to Mark Ruskell?
Thanks, Kavina. Morning, everybody. Just staying on those relaxation regulations then, will those actually be laid in Parliament next week? So this committee will have an opportunity to formally scrutinise them, but also vote on them ahead of Christmas. And will there be a full risk assessment accompanying with regulations as well, so that this committee and this committee's scientific advisors can look at the rationale behind the relaxation?
Well, this is guidance, Mr. Ruskell. This is guidance that was published this morning. The guidance is published. It will be provided to the committee. I'm sure the committee can take its position on the guidance, and I'm sure it will. We've worked very closely, obviously, with the other administrations in the UK, and we'll continue to work with those administrations to try and make sure that there is as full an understanding as possible.
So will we get the risk assessment behind those decisions so that our scientific advisors can look at decisions?
Well, there's a lot of material published every day in terms of where things are. I don't know what more information that Jason Leach knows can be or will be published. I mean, I want to stress the general point that we tend to publish everything we have in terms of the data that we're using, and that there's a great deal of it around there. But perhaps Jason would just want to argue, want to give us information about the scientific background to this. You know, this is, as the First Minister has pointed out, there is risk attached to this, and therefore we should have a discussion about it. But I think overwhelmingly people felt that something was required to be done. But maybe Jason would want to add to that.
There's a lot of requests for individual pieces of guidance or advice that simply aren't available in that form. There isn't a risk assessment, whatever that might be, for this specific decision. There are a series of conversations. There's all of the data that we publish now on the dashboard. There is the local authority published data every week that is updated every day for those local authorities. And you can almost hear the risk assessment in what the First Minister says every day from the podium when she describes the decision-making that has to be gone through to get to there. I'm afraid a single document that outlines the number of people who will get this infection and the number of people who won't if you do X, Y, or Z, it's simply impossible. I was asked by nearly every journalist yesterday at the briefing if I had such a document, and if I did, I would be the first to give them it, because I am worried about any relaxation of restrictions at any time, never mind during the Christmas period. So the knowledge we have is the same as yours, other than we bring some clinical expertise to that decision making.
That's a bit concerning if you don't have a clear understanding about whether this is going to increase the prevalence of COVID or reduce
it. That's not what I said, Mr. Ruskell. Any relaxation will increase the prevalence of the virus, very, very clearly. Okay. If you allow travel around the country, if you allow households to mix, prevalence will increase. The question is, inside a balanced set of decisions, is that the right thing to do? Because people are going to do it anyway. It's a very, very important holiday for social isolation, as well as for family time. And lots of people have been alone for 11 months. So the balance of the public health advice was that we should create some kind of framework in which that could happen. We don't make the choices. The decision makers at a four country level then chose the brackets around which they would set those guides. And we agreed with them. Now we're in the position where in Scotland we are making some choices about what the family size should be, whether we should say, yes, knock yourself out, go for it, or our version is think very carefully. If you need it for social isolation purposes, do it. If you don't need it, so my parents, just pushing 80, but living together, relatively healthy and well, I will not be having them round for Christmas.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that. Can I turn to the situation in Perth and Kinross and Fife? So both these areas obviously moved up to level three. In the case of Perth and Kinross,
to just add one point. I was trying to get in there, but the people can I just make a point? Because I want to quote from the guidance again, because it's really important in the light of what Jason said. The guidance says, over the past few months, this is paragraph four, over the past few months, we've all made sacrifices to keep ourselves and loved ones safe. Now that effective vaccines are on the horizon and the hope of a return to more normality by next spring is growing, we must all consider carefully the risk that is associated with coming together for Christmas. There is an acceptance, and it is quite clear in what Jason said, it's clear in the guidance of that risk. We are saying to people, we understand that risk, there is a risk, and we hope that people will judge whether or not to contribute to or to be part of activities that will be risky. That is very clear, and I just want to stress that point. Thank you. I'm sorry to interrupt you, Mr. Ruskell, but I think it's an important point I needed to make.
No, I appreciate that point. I was asking about the situation and Fife, which both moved up to level three. With Perth and Kinross, it fell below the indicators for level three. But in the assessment, there was an assessment done for this. It said that there's no confidence that established growth in COVID will be slowed or reversed. And that's why it was moved into level three. So I wanted to ask you, kind of, has that actually happened? Has it slowed or reversed in the last few weeks? And in relation to Fife, there was two indicators that obviously put it into level three, and that was the positivity rate and the intensive care unit capacity. So I wanted to ask whether, with both these local authorities, what has changed in the last few weeks?
I think Jason should address that.
Yeah. Mr. Ruskell, thank you. You have the same data available to you as I have. You have this document, which is now published every week. You can see the graph and the direction of said graph. The only thing I have, in addition to you, is the ability to personally talk to the Director of Public Health. Although they would happily speak to you as well, I'm quite sure. But that's the only extra intelligence I get, which gives us some local knowledge about, well, let's take a different example, Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire. Numbers increasing over the last couple of days, but when you speak to the Grampian Director of Public Health, they say, well, we have a couple of very serious outbreaks in specific locations. They are contained. Of course, they are dangerous to the people who catch the virus there, but they are not in the broader community. So therefore, we think on balance, we can maintain those local authorities at their existing level and deal with the outbreak. The conversation in Fife and Perth and Kinross is slightly different. So for the record, the Perth and Kinross numbers, so my my graph takes me up to the 21st of, I wish they would print these with slightly bigger print, honestly, the 21st of November. Now, remember, we have to have a lag time because it's date of test rather than date of reporting of test. So that's why there's a little bit of a gap to today. And the graph continues to rise, but very, very slowly in Perth and Kinross, now at the level it's at. So the last 5 days, 109, 115, 115, 116, 108. So stable, but up 14% in 7 days. And that's why we thought level three previously was needed to pull that down and hopefully just turn that corner. So it appears to have stabilized. The positivity rate up as high as 5 and now at 4.7. So Perth looks as though it has flattened, but it certainly hasn't turned the corner. And Fife, a little bit earlier, if you remember, than Perth and Kinross, into level three. So forgive me not knowing exactly, maybe 10 days, maybe 2 weeks. Yeah. Down 27% in the last 7 days, which is what you would expect if level three does what we want it to do, and the population of these local authorities follow the guidance. They're the ones who are doing it, not us. And the curve in Fife has begun to tip over. Now, they started from a higher base, so they were at 146 at their highest. Remember, the Scottish average today is about 120, down from 140 2 weeks ago, so going definitely in the right direction. For comparison, the other four UK countries, Northern Ireland is 169, Wales is 194, and England is 218. It's not a competition, but I just do it for transparency. And Fife now, in the last two days, reported here 110 and 106. So that looks as though Fife is turning. But remember, turning is not enough to get you to level two. It has to be consistent. And it has to be long, because 106 is still too high.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Can I just ask a final question about how we're supporting people in self-isolation? So there was a King's College study that was done looking at people across the UK that found that only 18% of those with symptoms are effectively self-isolating. Only 11% who've been contact traced were effectively self-isolating. Do you have figures for Scotland, and are you thinking about how we can improve self-isolation support? So New York, for example, you know, people can get access to free hotels, they can get food, care packages, PPE. You know, for people who are struggling to self-isolate because they don't have adequate housing or have other pressures in their lives, then you know, do you not think that points to why we're seeing such a low rate of effective self-isolation?
New York is having again, Mr. Russell.
On you go, Jason, please.
New York is having a absolutely horrid second wave. It's absolute misery. And my colleagues who are running that response are really, really struggling. The King's College paper, I think it's the one I'm thinking of, Mr. Russell, forgive me if I get it wrong, asked people on a 7-point scale how well they are self-isolating. And in order to get a 7, you had to basically be 100% isolating from your own family, from going outdoors. So if you lived alone, you couldn't leave. So very, very strict definition of self-isolation, which is the correct definition. It's what we tell people to do. But even if you said, I have occasionally broken the rules, so I am a 6, that's where you get the low teen percentages. We're pretty confident in Scotland from our polling data, from conversations that we have with people, that we're way higher than that, but we're not at 100%. And one of the reasons is exactly as you described, the support we can provide for people, the financial support, the local authority support, and the individual family support to provide that. And we've done our absolute best with local authorities, with supermarkets, with third sector organisations to get that number up as high as we can. But there's absolutely more we could continue to do.
Well, what should we do then?
I think the key is local authorities, actually. The financial support is above my pay grade, so I'll leave that to Mr. Russell. And we have, with the other three UK countries, brought in a self-isolation payment. And I think the individual local authorities and their connection, particularly to those who are on benefits or are in local authority housing, those who would struggle with that self-isolation, perhaps for financial reasons, I think the local authority relationship in there is crucial. And my reading of the conversations I've had with them is they're doing a fantastic job and getting better at that support.
Does the Cabinet Secretary want to add anything to that?
No, I mean, we keep the issue of financial support and support, particularly for people who are self-isolating, very much under review, and we will do everything we can to support them. There are a whole range of competing priorities. I did note the study of the mass vaccination in Liverpool also drew attention to the fact that those in the most marginal communities were the ones who were least likely both to get a test, to present themselves for testing, and to isolate. And we are very aware of that. And therefore, you know, we it is an issue we address as often as we can, we'll continue to address.
Thank you for that. Mark Ruskell, is that all your questions?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that the last question to the Cabinet Secretary on the back of that would be about whether the government is looking at making the self-isolation support grants unconditional or less conditional. I mean, that's certainly something which is being done in New Zealand. You know, you don't have to be on benefits to get the support grant in New Zealand.
Well, within our capabilities, and you know, they are not unfortunately infinite, and you know, that is one of the problems that we have. We will certainly continue to look at all options. I can certainly say.
Okay. All right.
Thank you. Next, Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everybody. I wonder if I could start by asking a question, probably both to Cabinet Secretary and to Professor Leach. It's about how we have treated the smaller businesses within our towns compared to how we are treating the larger businesses and stores. What my local constituents and business owners tell me is that they've done everything we've asked them to do. They are very careful about arrangements in small shops and places and so on. They do track and trace. They've done everything that we've asked them to do to comply with. Yet the bigger stores and so on, supermarkets and big stores, don't do any track and trace, and they're generally filled with people doing some kind of degree of shopping or otherwise. So they see an imbalance there, Cabinet Secretary, in the impact that this is having on them compared to the impact that it's having on the bigger stores. And they're always asking for an explanation why that is. They've done everything they can, but the numbers perhaps in Ayrshire, you can see that, are still relatively high. So could you offer us a few comments, please, on that kind of question and how we can try to address their concerns about this?
Well, you know, I think to start with, there are very strict regulations and very strict expectations of all stores, and particularly of large stores, which are, you know, classed as places for essential shopping. And these should not be lax, and they should be observed to the letter. And if they are not being observed to the letter, then complaints should be made at appropriate level, and action should be taken. So there's no question of, you know, I think, Mr. Coffey, we've addressed this with you before. There is no question of large stores just being allowed away with things. That also includes work in government to make sure that stores and chains understand this. So there is no laxity. And if there's any laxity shown, it should be picked up and it should be dealt with very, very promptly. Equally, there is no blame attached to small stores, you know, for in some way not doing things. It's simply that there have to be restrictions applied that are going to be effective. And you know, one of the restrictions that needs to be applied, we know, is the prevalence of the virus passing on in small areas, in confined areas, in shopping experience. I remember Jason will have more detail of this, but I remember seeing some figures recently about in track and trace, the number of contacts gained through shopping. And you know, and it is a concern. So nobody is blaming them. Nobody is saying they've done anything wrong. It is simply that they are particularly vulnerable in terms of where the virus may pass on. Now we want to move through that, and equally we want to provide. And this goes into the second part of it. And we want to provide as much support as we can. I mean, you, Mr. Coffey, in your constituency will have businesses who believe they've not had enough support. I have businesses who I absolutely myself believe have not had enough support, and I am constantly drawing them to the attention of the local authority, asking about discretionary funds, talking to ministers about what funding packages are going to come forward, encouraging them to look at local authority websites, to look at the UK government website and our websites to see what is available. And that will continue for as long as this goes on, because there will always be people who have not yet been able to access support, and we want to make sure they do. This is a terrible time for them. And, you know, I absolutely recognise that. I mean, you, like me, like every constituency MSP, will feel this very deeply on a daily basis, because we're meeting people who are suffering very greatly, you know, who stand the risk or may have lost their businesses and their livelihoods as from no fault of their own. And I don't think any of us can treat that with equanimity. We have to do our very best for them. But I think we all have to accept that the actions being taken, while not perfect, and certainly, you know, we will look back on some of these and say, maybe we should have done some. The actions being taken for the best of intentions and with the intention saving lives primarily, and making sure that our health service does not become overwhelmed, and making sure that we are protecting the most vulnerable of our fellow citizens. And there's no easy answer then to some questions about the fact that people are suffering. I wish there was. I really do wish there was, but there isn't. Jason might want to say something about the background too.
I think this is a tough one, Mr. Coffey. I genuinely do. I've never liked the distinction between essential and non-essential, particularly if it's your gift shop or your so-called non-essential shop in Hindland Main Street, then it's pretty essential for you and your family and those you employ. And it's with a heavy heart that we give advice ever about closing businesses. The support package in place for those businesses, again, is for Mr. Russell, not for me, but I can tell you that the public health advice will be to open them just as soon as we think it is safe to do so. I've been very impressed with my local community and their ability to switch to outdoor provision, to online provision, to delivery, and a lot of companies have a lot of really small businesses have stepped up, particularly for Christmas, to try and get some resource and revenue through their doors, and it's been very impressive to do it. But the public health advisors are under no illusion that business closure is a public health problem. It is not just an economic problem. So we do it with a very heavy heart, and we hope they'll be open just as soon as we can. And the way to get them open is to go down the levels. The way to go down the levels is to get the prevalence down.
Thanks to both of you for those responses. It's more a question about small versus big rather than essential versus non-essential. If I go down to Kilmarnock after this meeting and any of the towns and villages in my constituency there, by and large, most of the stuff's closed. Most of the shops are closed other than food and carry-out places and so on. So they've done it all. People are asking me, where are the cases coming from? If we're closed and people aren't coming to us and people are obeying the regulations about household visits and so on, they then say to me, well, the cases must be coming from the bigger stores and the mixing and mingling of bigger numbers in the bigger stores. Is there any substance to that, do you think? Because the numbers of cases in Ayrshire are still at a reasonably high level above the Scottish average, enough to keep us at level 4. So where are the cases coming from if the town is near enough empty of any activity and mixing and mingling of the population?
I think I've said before, Mr. Coffey, it's the most common question I get asked. Every sector thinks it's not happening in their sector, and every individual gets surprised when they get a virus diagnosis. Every single person I know who's had this virus gets a surprise when they get the positive test. Nobody thinks it's happening in their home, their shop, their pub. The fact is, the only way to reduce the prevalence is to reduce human interaction. And therefore, you've got to work your way through that list of human interaction places to get the prevalence down. Non-essential retail, so-called, small shops, whatever, is quite low down that list. That's why it's only in level 4 and not in level 3. But if your numbers are still high, you've got to tick off those final few places in order to get that down. It's a matter of compliance, partly, where those are still coming from. And it's a lag time because Ayrshire and Arran's only been in level four for X amount of weeks. So it simply takes a bit of time for those numbers to come through, as we just discussed. Fife beginning to turn the corner. The last few days would suggest the country is just beginning to turn a corner. The R rate, we think, is below one and has been for a week, maybe. So it's slow, but it's coming. Our numbers are still way too high, and compared to the summer, hugely too high. But the sacrifice will be worth it, and the worst thing we can do is allow those shops to open and then have another close or multiple closures in the months to come. We're trying to avoid that.
Just lastly on the kind of mechanism of track and trace, I'm sure we've all went into a wee shop and we've given them our name and our phone number and so on, but you don't do that when you go into a supermarket or a big store. Is it just impossible? Is the technology just not there? Or would it create more problems than we can deal with? Because it seems to me, and constituents ask me this as well, why don't they do track and trace in big supermarkets? So that we can try to reduce the numbers that might be coming into bigger settings like that and spreading the virus out.
What Test and Protect needs is proximity data, wherever it is, whether you're on a train or a small shop or a big shop or in your house. So when Test and Protect phone you, they say, where were you and who were you with? Now, if you say, forgive the shorthand, if you say I was in Tesco in the washing powder aisle at 11 a.m., it's going to be almost impossible to find out who else was in the washing powder aisle less than 2 metres away from you, even if you do names and addresses at the door. But if you're in the gift shop up the road from me, and you say, I was in the gift shop at 11 o'clock, I signed in and out, and there was a man who came in after me, and we were looking at Christmas decorate, whatever. That's a much easier place for Test and Protect to get the information from. So it's a judgment, Mr. Coffey. It's a judgment about should you do it in pubs where people are isolated, people are there for quite a long time, restaurants where it might be 90 minutes. So in the bigger places, it gets almost impossible to get that real proximity data that Test and Protect would need. That's why we have the app. So the app is one of the crucial tools to allow us to do that. And the Test and Protect data at the door of places is an additional layer which the directors of public health would call on if they felt they needed it. They don't always need it. It's if they need the map of the establishment. So some of the Aberdeen hospitality outbreaks, they looked at maps of the cafes and the restaurants and said, well, Frank is a positive. Frank was at this table. He was at that table for X amount of time. We need to talk to all the people around there. Who were they? That's much harder, the bigger the institution.
Okay. Thank you so much for that. That really helps, that explanation. Thank you for that. Thank you, Convener.
Convener, before you move to the next question, could I just make a point? Beatrice Wishart raised the question of overnight ferry journeys, and I think it is an example of how this committee is very important. There has been, I know, since she raised the point, some discussion about overnight ferry journeys, and I think that the guidance will be clarified to say that if you start your journey of an overnight ferry journey on the 27th, and that will apply largely to Shetland, then that will be within the regulations. So given that it is a very long journey, then if you start your journey on the 27th coming back, then that will count as if you were observing the regulations. The only exceptions to the overall regulations, however, apart from that, would be if somebody was taken ill, or whether if there was weather disruption. But I would want Beatrice Wishart to know that, so that we are trying to listen to concerns, and that concern was well received, and we've been able to respond to it very quickly.
Thank you for that clarification. That's very helpful. Could I turn next, please, to Maurice Corry?
Thank you, Convener. On that point, if I may come back to the Cabinet Secretary, the question of starting your journey, returning journey from the festive period, Cabinet Secretary, by road, rail or other means, is that allowable if somebody leaves at, say, 10 o'clock on the night of the 27th and returns into Scotland in the early hours of the morning? Is that permissible?
Well, I'd want to go away and think about that. I mean, I don't want to say that we will that the 23rd to 27th are not absolutes, because clearly that is what we are talking about. But given that Beatrice Wishart's point is a good point, and with an overall, the Shetland Ferry does operate overnight, I think we've been very quick to say, yeah, that's a fair point. If Mr. Corey will leave that with me, I'll look at it. But I don't want to give the impression that this is porous on both ends. It is not porous. And I go back to, you know, the point in the regulations, we must all consider carefully the risk that is associated with coming together for Christmas. That risk will grow with every day it grows. So if the 27th becomes halfway into the 28th, the risk grows, and we need to recognize that risk grows. But in the interest of fairness, and to show that I will listen to all members of the committee, not just Beatrice Wishart, I will provide the committee with an answer to that.
That's fine. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Obviously, that applies to sleeper travel as well on the railways. Can I come to my next point? It's for Professor Leach. Professor, how concerned are you about the relaxation of the regulations over the Christmas period from a medical and infection point of view in Scotland?
I wondered how long it would take for somebody to ask me that question, Mr. Corey. I'm glad you have. I am concerned. I'm also a human being with a family, and not to put too small a point on it, that balance we're going to strike for you, for me, and for the whole population. But my position is this is the biggest religious and secular holiday in the United Kingdom. We have, of course, come through a host of religious moments. It's Hanukkah in a week. It was Eid. It was Easter. And everybody has had to adapt to those. And we're going to have to adapt to our Christmas and our New Year in Scotland to these restrictions. I see a light at the end of the tunnel. I am very encouraged by the plan for vaccination. The research data is good. Our logistical plan is forming and is encouraging and good. So I just don't want to put that at risk. So the conversation I had with my own parents and my own sister, by Zoom, of course, was that I would much rather have 10, 15 more Christmases than put this single Christmas at risk. And my dad said, I knew that in my heart, but I didn't want you to say it. And I think that's the conversation a lot of families will have around the country. Now, if my mum or my dad lived alone and I hadn't seen them for X number of months, I may make a different choice. And I'm not going to impose my choice on you or on others. And everybody should make that risk-based choice for themselves. And that's why we've allowed this freedom. But the travel conversation is one such time. We should try and stay within, not push it. We should try and restrict it. So if you're going to do it one day. Don't do it 5 days. Mm-hmm. If you have to travel, then of course travel. But do it for social isolation reasons. Don't do it just because you can. Because interaction will cause prevalence to rise. There isn't any question about that. Not to prolong this answer, but if you look at the Canadian Thanksgiving data, it will give you serious cause for thought, because Canada told everybody to be very careful, and their prevalence went high after Canadian Thanksgiving. I'm afraid American Thanksgiving, which is today, we fear that will do exactly the same.
Thank you, Professor Leach. I think that's indicative of your concerns, particularly in relation to your parents' situation. That was very helpful. Can I turn to the Cabinet Secretary now about childcare? What is currently permitted under the current regulations for a grandparent or grandparents in helping their families with childcare? It seems to be quite a woolly area.
And particularly, I don't want to add to the wool, so rather than express an opinion, I will make sure that I give you the definitive answer in writing. Broadly, we've tried to make sure that childcare is still permitted and still covered, because we want to make sure the ultimate normality, but I don't want to in any sense add to confusion, so we will make sure that you get a response to it.
Thank you very much indeed. And one final question, if I may, Convener, to Cabinet Secretary again. Well, and Ken, Professor Leach may answer as well, is a question of airport testing. How close are we to getting a solution to this to ensure we can get some reasonable way forward in testing of travellers leaving this country or indeed returning. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'll ask Jason to talk specifically about airport testing, but can I just make a point about travel for the umpteenth time? We are discouraging people from travel, even when it is technically permitted. We are discouraging people from travel, particularly and including overseas travel. So the fact that there would be an airport test does not mean that then, whoopee, you know, we can go and travel somewhere. That should not be the case. And I hope everybody who is considering overseas travel will only do that in extremis. There are people, of course, who have to travel for urgent business. There are people who tragically have to travel because they've lost a family member or something and want to be with other family members. But please, if you can avoid traveling, do not travel. Now, perhaps Jason would say a word about actual testing.
That would have been my first point. Please don't travel for recreation at the present time. This pandemic is global. It is accelerating in 5 of the 6 WHO regions, and it is dangerous to visit many countries just now because you are likely to bring the virus either to them or bring the virus home. And lots of countries won't let you in without quarantine anyway. So I would discourage recreational travel. However, we need to find a way out of this, and travel is going to be one of the things we're going to have a new version of. The UK government has announced a testing and release programme for quarantine, which we will watch very, very carefully. We are slightly concerned about the percentage release that will be caused by release on day 8 or day 7 or whatever that is. So there's still a bit of work to do there. And in Scotland, the airport, I think just Edinburgh, has announced an outbound test that you can now buy. For instance, if you wish to go to Dubai, they require you to have a test before you arrive. Our difficulty with that has always been scientific, not economic. Our public health difficulty with that is you can't find incubating virus. You simply can't find it. And therefore, if you get a negative test on a Tuesday, you could still be incubating the virus and take it to Dubai on the Wednesday. So we have to be sensible scientifically about what testing will do for us inside a regime of travel that will have to come back. Low prevalence will allow more travel. I'm sorry to come back to the same old tone, but if you get the prevalence down and you have less virus, then travel will become much more possible.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Our next question has come from Annabel Ewing, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning again to the Cabinet Secretary and to Professor Leach. Something I look forward to now is a Thursday morning, not a Wednesday morning. First of all, can I just say I'm very pleased to hear from Professor Leach, he'll note my interest in the subject as the MSP for Leith, that life seems to be making very good progress, because he'll recall that I asked him last week about monitoring ICU beds and so forth, and he indicated at that time that Fife was looking a wee bit like a high level 3. So I'm really, really pleased to hear this bit of good news, and long may it continue. Turning briefly to the travel guidance published today, obviously we await clarification on the returning home bit on the 27th, but I do appreciate the point that these are the maximum parameters, and it's really except in exceptional circumstances, for example, getting to or from Shetland or the like, that this should be the maximum parameters and not eked out over, you know, other days. But just with regard to what you can do when you get to your bubble, could perhaps maybe Professor Leach clarify that, in that, you know, in terms of going somewhere for a visit to an attraction or to a hospitality, particularly if you are coming from a level 3, level 4 to a lower level. So perhaps I could start with Professor Leach on that, and then maybe the CAPSEC has something to say. Thank you.
Our fundamental advice would be, once you are in your bubble, you have taken quite a lot of risk already. So if you have joined together as potentially 3 households, plus an extended household, maybe, up to a certain number, then you've already taken quite a lot of your risk. You have to follow the guidance of the level you are in when you get there, wherever that is, whichever house you've decided to visit or to stay in. So that will mean we don't quite know yet, of course, what levels will be applicable on the 23rd of December. We're hopeful that much of the country will have come down by then, but we just simply don't know. So you will be, I hope, allowed to go to a place of worship on Christmas Eve, for example, or on Christmas Day, or whenever your services are, but we would expect you still to distance, still to keep to the numerical limits, still to keep to hand washing and all of those other elements. So fundamentally, as you're now bubble, you're still trying your best to distance within that bubble, you're still trying your best to clean surfaces, to wash your hands, and you have to follow the rules inside the level in which you are presently. So we've just removed temporarily the travel restriction, but there will still be levels in place in each of the local authorities in Scotland.
Yeah, the guidance it goes into some detail on this, and I would commend it to members. You know, there's issues such as tourist accommodation, hospitality, worship. They are all within the guidance. But you know, the basic rule is, you know, as Jason has quite rightly said, you have already taken a significant risk by, you know, joining that bubble. You shouldn't do anything to extend that risk if you can, obviously, if you can possibly avoid it, you just shouldn't do it. And you should be conscious of that. So we are asking people to be very, very cautious, recognizing the special nature of the time, but being very cautious. And also, I just want to absolutely underline what you said at the beginning. Those 4 days, the 23rd to 27th included, those 5 days are absolutely the limits, you know, and should be treated as the limits. And if you can do things in less, you should do things in less. If you can not do things at all, you should not do things at all.
Well, I thank the clarification from both gentlemen, and just a follow-up on this issue, and then I've got another area to turn to, if I may, Convener. So I also understand that in advance of, if, for those who feel they have to take up this because of their own personal circumstances, this slight relaxation, I understand that there would be perhaps advice to do what they can before they take up the bubble, before they travel, to try to you know, keep themselves apart and so forth, to minimise any further risks of cross-contamination. I wonder if Professor Leach and then the Cabinet Secretary could comment specifically on that point. What would you say to people who would think, actually, in the circumstances, I really need to take up this possible relaxation? So what should they do to best place themselves in advance of that trip at Christmas?
Again, we'll outline it in the guidance, but the basic instruction, guidance, advice will be that you should turn down social interaction in order to make yourself as safe as you can prior to joining that Christmas bubble. A bit like we did with students, and the same advice we'll be giving to students at the beginning and end of this, the end of this term and the start of next term, exactly the same. You are likely to be safer for your family if you have turned down your number of social interactions or work interactions or study interactions between now and forming your bubble. And it's fairly common sense. If I were doing it with my family, that's what I would do. It's not quite self-isolation, but you could try, which you should be doing anyway, of course, try and limit your interaction with other people prior to joining that bubble and get everybody else to do the same.
The guidance is very clear on that. It says you should limit your social contact with others as far as you can before and after forming a bubble to minimise transmission risks and protect your loved ones.
Okay, thanks. I obviously have not had a chance to read the guidance in detail yet, but I will be doing so, so also I can help to answer, I'm sure, questions that will start flowing in from constituents. Turning to a different issue, but actually one that's already been referred to this morning, and that is particularly the large supermarkets and their approach to face coverings. Now, I'm increasingly getting traffic from constituents who, you know, are angry, frustrated, worried that they're going to all the large supermarkets and with varying degrees of non-compliance in that regard. You know, I note that the Cabinet Secretary had said in answer to an earlier question around this subject that they're, of course, subject to strict regulation and complaints should be made at the appropriate level and action should be taken. So I'm asking, what action will the Scottish Government take? Because presumably they can write to each of the chief execs of all the large supermarkets to remind them of the requirements placed on their organisation, legal requirements. Because frankly, for the, you know, my, you know, individual constituents, they may be fearful to make a complaint. They may not know how to go about it. They may feel that it doesn't carry very much weight. And lastly, it's not exclusively the large supermarkets. I get also issues raised about small shops where they may have taken up the issue with, in my case, Fife Council, the enforcement team, but they don't feel that anything really is done. So in responding, perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could also deal with what it is he expects local authority enforcement teams to do. And has he checked recently that they are doing what they're tasked to do? Because certainly, increasingly, a number of my constituents feel that that's the case.
Okay, I mean, they're good questions. And, you know, I can assure the member that my colleagues in government will and do remind large supermarkets and others of the requirements they have. But, you know, I note what she has said in this in terms of further reminder, and I will make sure that the Cabinet Secretary for, I think, the rural economy, who has responsibility for dealing with supermarkets, deals with this. He is also known to the member, and therefore I will make the point to him, and I'm sure she will make the point to him, that supermarkets need reminded. But of course, you know, and I'm sure she does, knowing the member well, I'm sure she does make representations herself when constituents come to her, and they make the point both locally to the store, and if the store at local level is unable to do something, then more widely to the store at more senior level and to the management of the company, that any breach of the regulations is unacceptable. Councils must also take this seriously, and I know they do. But there is also pressure on councils. I mean, for example, you know, I'm sorry to raise the dreaded word, but environmental health officers, who will be particularly concerned about this, are also in the front line of issues around Brexit at the moment. And there are not enough environmental health officers to cover all of these things. They're also the people who are in meat packing plants and meat and other places trying to ensure compliance, and also trying to make sure that outbreaks are contained. So there is a lot of pressure upon all of these people and all of us to make sure it's done. But councils want to make sure that the observation takes place. But of course, there is also a requirement for people to recognise themselves that observation should take place. So each of us should be saying, when we need to say it, look, this isn't right. We need to get this sorted. What's gone wrong here? And we've all got that obligation, because we're all in this together.
Well, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. And I guess an appropriate channel of communication would be Cabinet Secretary to Cabinet Secretary with regard to the supermarket issue. But on the importance of local government enforcement, I mean, I do absolutely get, and the Cabinet Secretary knows this because I sit also in the Culture and Europe Tourism Committee, that you know, the Brexit shambles is, you know, impacting negatively on every area of our lives, and the UK government's abject failure to prepare to provide any guidance about preparation that's meaningful to economic activity in our country. But equally, you know, for the individual constituent, they may feel, if they go into a local shop, a bigger shop, they may just feel a wee bit tentative about there and then raising the issue. But I do understand that we need feedback. We need the feedback, and therefore I've got bigger shoulders. I'm the MSP, and I'm happy to do that. But just to put that point in context, because it would be perhaps quite brave for some individuals to make that point directly in a shop. They feel a wee bit fearful of doing that. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary understands that point very well.
I do, and I've taken up myself and my office have taken those issues up with supermarkets within my own constituency, recognising that the individuals concerned do not wish to do so, but we are able to do so, and that's one of the roles we have. As councillors, would have too.
Sure. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you.
Shona Robertson, please.
Good morning, everyone. I have a couple of questions. One, it won't surprise you, is about the local situation in Dundee. Pleased to see that there was a 24% drop in cases per 100,000. And I guess just asking whether, as we head towards the next review period, whether that bodes well potentially for a move to level two, if that continues, is the message really, the Dundonians keep doing what you're doing, and if that trend continues, it could bode well for a move to level two.
Jason, I think.
So I can exclusively reveal, Ms. Robertson, that I think I have two more days of data than you, and it has stayed stable in those 2 days, 106, 104. It's down 29% in a 7 day period from a high in this 10-day period of 145, so it's now below the Scottish average, which is very significant because fundamentally, if you're going to look at one piece of data, which of course we warn against because these decisions are made in the round, roughly speaking, local authorities above the Scottish average are in level four and local authorities below the Scottish average are in lower levels. It's not quite as simple as that, but that's kind of how it has worked out. So Dundee City now finds itself below the Scottish average of cases per 100,000, but over 100 is still high. If you remember, the WHO target for control of the pandemic is 50, and we have very few local authorities at 50, which is why we have nationwide restrictions, of course, and why Dundee City was put into level three and has done well to get to where it is. The last 4 days are stable, and this is what we're seeing in level three. We're seeing stubborn stability in level three. And to turn that corner is really hard. And that's why a lot of areas have had to go into level four, because they've stuck at 140, 150 to get them down. Dundee starts from a better place. And I think your advice is absolutely correct. People should be very careful about social interaction. They should be careful in the hospitality they're allowed to go to, in the shops they're allowed to go to, and get that down. And then I will be the first to recommend level two if it's the right time to do so.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. A very clear message. I want to turn to the guidance, which I've been trying to plough my way through during the meeting. I want to just pick up on, first of all, the issue of people who had been asked to shield previously. So obviously we're talking about those who are potentially most vulnerable. Now, the guidance, I'm not going to read it all, but in summary, it basically says that people should take time to think about what being in a bubble means, but it obviously involves greater risk as you'd be increasing the number of people you have contact with. Essentially, it says don't feel pressurised, but you have to make the judgment about whether or not it's a risk too far. And it ends with saying a link to further guidance on this to follow. It's just really to ask, is that further guidance that's to follow going to give people more ability and information in making that judgment? Because it is obviously a very difficult judgment for people to make based on their own circumstances. So what are we likely to see in that further guidance? What kind of things will it cover?
Jason, perhaps?
So this was a big concern for us, Ms. Robertson, as you can imagine. Fundamentally, what we've done with that higher risk group now is offered them the same advice of the rest of the population, but told them to be more careful. And that's it's not the most individualised advice, but we would ask them to talk to their care team if they're particularly worried, and certainly talk to their family. So, for example, if they are often, ironically, the most socially isolated group, and therefore the Christmas relaxation may be the very thing to do for them, but perhaps with one other family rather than two other families. Perhaps to join their extended family for Christmas dinner, but not have other people in that family. And then think about the nature of the family you're joining. So let me take my example. If I had my normal Christmas dinner in that room, I would have two people who are out at work every day, and I would have four people who aren't at work every day. So their risk is, of course, slightly higher, no matter what they do for a living, if they're travelling, if they're in a workplace. So So think, for example, about who and what nature that family is you're meeting and the risk. And we talked already about restricting your social interaction prior. So the family you are going to have Christmas dinner with or Christmas Eve with, can they restrict their social interactions? Is it possible? Or are they an MSP who has to go to work? Or are they somebody who is an essential frontline health worker who has to go to work, whose risk is, of course, slightly high? The further guidance will be in broad terms about taking care in that high-risk group. And if people are worried beyond the conversation they're having with their own family, they should talk to their individual care team.
And is that further guidance imminent? Is it going to be in the next few days? Or
yes.
When?
Yes. Okay. And it's being considered at, sorry, it's being considered at two levels. So there will be, there's a UK clinical committee on which my deputy sits around that high-risk group, risk assessments, all of the things that we do for that high-risk group, and then there'll be Scottish advice about what we think that should be. We'll also do some extra guidance about care home visiting, about hospital visiting, about these subsets of the major Christmas relaxations.
Okay. We've talked a lot this morning about the balance of risk and how difficult that is. And one of the things that struck me looking through the guidance was that children under 12 do not need to maintain social distance. Now, I get that because getting, you know, particularly small children to socially distance is almost an impossible thing. But children under 12 blanketly not needing to social distance. Now, you can imagine, obviously, children are out and about. And if you had vulnerable grandparents, say, taking part in the festive activities and there's no social distancing, is that too much of a risk? I mean, should we be saying to people, you know, we understand the difficulties of children not, socially distancing, and we understand the desire to have, you know, hugs at Christmas time, but you know, that again feels to me something that just may be slightly risky, given that children will be mixing at school right up until the Christmas break.
I'm glad you're cautious, Ms. Robinson. I like caution in these circumstances. That's no change to the existing rules. So that is the present rule. You don't have to physically distance if you're under 12. But we don't suggest that you should throw caution to the wind. We think you should still be very careful about hand washing for children, for surfaces that children touch, all of those other elements. The risk of infection in under 12s is lower than the rest of the population, and their ability to transmit the disease is lower than the rest of the population. And therefore, the clinical advice is, frankly, that is a risk that it is okay to take, but it is not risk-free. There is no risk-free route here. So think carefully about the nature of your bubble. Think carefully about the number of under 12s who would be in that bubble, and make a risk-based judgment in your own family.
So really what you're saying is, you know, all these are guidelines, and if you have someone who may be at particular risk, but they still want to be part of that family gathering, which they may not have been doing up until now, this may be a new thing that even, you know, with children under 12, that, you know, that should be taken into account in judging the overall risk, particularly if someone hasn't been really socially mixing and this might be the first time that they are, that really they should be thinking quite carefully about all of these risks.
Correct. Absolutely correct. And this is so difficult because the only thing we could have done that was definitive is kept all the restrictions in place. That's the only real other alternative here. And we thought, from a public health perspective, and the decision makers agreed, that that was too harsh. So therefore, we've had to allow the population to make some choices. And I think the population has done very well up to this point, and I trust them to be able to do this as safely as possible. But you're right. Your advice to your constituents and our national advice will be to do this very, very cautiously, depending on your own individual circumstances. And if you have a high-risk individual inside that bubble, you should be more cautious than if you don't.
Just finally, again, maybe this to Jason Leach, that, you know, there is a perception that there's a clamour to, you know, get rid of the, you know, the restrictions and everybody to get together. And, you know, there is an element of that in my mailbag. However, I've been quite surprised by how many constituents have got in touch with me feeling the other way, that they're actually very concerned about the level of risk and what the impact may be on the numbers following Christmas. So I think it's just to put that on the record. It probably won't be a surprise, but I think it's important. And maybe I was a little bit surprised by the weight of that balance, that there's a lot of caution out there, and maybe that's a good thing in terms of the messaging that's been given this morning.
I think it is. And the polling, our polling data suggests it's kind of evenly split, which probably means we've got it about right, that some want more freedom, some want less freedom, and some are going to ignore whatever we do. And I think we should provide guidance as best we can, and then the population should choose carefully what they do according to their circumstances.
Okay, thank you.
And finally, the Deputy Convener, Monica Lennon.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Convener. Colleagues have helpfully asked questions already about Section 16 and 17 of the Act and the statutory instrument in front of us today for information. And the Cabinet Secretary's responses have been helpful, as well as his officials. But I just want to get some clarification, because the Cabinet Secretary has noted my interest in the subject. Can I perhaps ask, and perhaps David and Rod might be the best place to help. You have explained that there are concerns about increased demand on children's services over the winter period. Can I ask what the scale of that demand is expected to be, and will that be uniform across Scotland?
I think Rod might be best placed to answer that at this stage. Rod is still
monitor.
That's it, you're now free. Yeah,
I'm now free, right, okay, thank you. Right, I have to say, we do monitor the demand for children's services on a weekly basis. For example, child protection registrations, there was a spike as we were coming out of lockdown, but that has stabilised since. Short answer to Ms Lennon's question is, we cannot absolutely quantify at this point in time what we think that the demand will be, but when we speak to chief social work officers, yes, they are concerned, as everyone is, with the winter situation, that there will be a spike in demand, and that's why we've asked this point, or that's why we've asked at this point in time for the emergency powers to be retained for children's services. As I said previously, it is absolutely all about getting services to the families who need them the most as quickly as possible. So I can't actually say what I think the demand will be, other than chief social work officers are feeding back to us that they are concerned that there will be a demand, as there will be demand for other services during the winter. We're absolutely aware of that. So I can't give definitive answers other than what we've been monitoring so far, which has been a spike coming out of lockdown, but then a stabilisation since. Hope that helps.
Thank you. That's helpful. That is helpful. Thank you.
And it is reassuring to hear that these issues are looked at on a weekly basis. I'm sure there is constant dialogue and discussion. I think earlier on you said that in terms of the local authorities who had used the powers or maybe taken advantage of the powers, it was only 4 local authorities, and that was both in terms of adult social care and children's services. So in terms of the provisions around children, and including, because I think Section 16, that also covers young carer statements, doesn't it? So on the one hand, maybe it's the way my brain works, but I feel conflicted, because we know that children's organisations, disabled people's organisations are saying that they really want these assessments to be done because that's in the best interest of service users. But I know you have to reconcile that with workforce and capacity within our local authorities. So is there a reason why the power in terms of councils having to do the young carer statements, why that's still in place? It just seems to me that we would need to have those statements, you know, more than ever. Maybe just a further explanation on that, please. That would be helpful.
Well, maybe if I ask David to start with that, but I mean, just to be clear, that the power still exists to have those. That power was not abolished. There is another power within the Act to do something else, which we regarded as necessary at that stage. Does David want to say a word or two about this?
I think maybe Rod, it would be best, Rod? on the carer statements.
Rod?
Hopefully I'm on mic now. Yes, thank you.
Yep.
Absolutely. Young carers' statements are a priority for every local authority I have spoken to. Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right to say that the powers are just that. They can be used, and only four local authorities have used the emergency powers, so full assessments for young carers' statements are being used in the other 28 local authorities. And I would emphasise it again, even if a partial assessment is done to look at support for young carers, it will still, that the statutory guidance focuses on the important things that are required in that assessment for the supports that need to be provided to a young carer or indeed any other child or family. So I can emphasise again that supports are still priority for young carers and are still being assessed and still being provided for. Yes, that's definite. It is a priority for us young carers. I'm very conscious of that, both from my local authority experience and indeed the contacts I have now from the Chief Social Work Advisor's office. Thanks.
Thank you. I think that will be reassuring for many people to hear. I know the Cabinet Secretary said that we're coming up to a reporting period, so we'll look at that further information as well as trying to get a sense of the backlog. Just a final question, Convener. I know that we've got a few colleagues that maybe have some supplementaries. It was just to turn back to the COVID-19 statement, and I was struck by Dr. Liz Cameron last week from Scottish Chamber of Commerce when she gave evidence to the committee, and she raised the point about the short notice period for businesses. And again, I think we all understand some of the practical issues around this. And my colleague Richard Leonard had also raised the impact on businesses and the financial losses for those who had to take staff off furlough and increase stock and so on, only to be told that they couldn't open. So I just wondered, has any assessment been done, Cabinet Secretary, of the financial impact of the timing of decisions and the notice period that businesses have if they are in an area that's changing levels? And I don't have another question, Convener.
We publish a business regulatory impact assessment for every set of regulation that is published and available. And a general point of principle, we'd like to give people as much notice as possible. Equally, we have to be able to, it's an old argument, we've been through this many times in the committee, we have to be able to take action when that action is required and not delay that action. So it is a balance between the two. I noticed that the Conservatives, for example, argued that there should be a week between any discussion and implementation, and then immediately broke it south of the border. So there is no hard and fast rule. We will give as much notice as we can. The rhythm we are getting into, I hope, and this meeting is part of that rhythm, of making sure that there is an understandable process being gone through and people know, and giving as much notice as possible. And that, as Jason Leach knows, is often a feature of Cabinet discussion, saying how much notice can be given, how much preparation can be given to people to say that certain things are under consideration, is always an element in discussion. But then so is the fact that, the moment you start to do that, people start to speculate, and that speculation isn't helpful. So I hear what Monica Lennon is saying. We are committed to as much notice as we can give, but it's very imperfect at the moment, given the nature of where we are.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think David Fotheringham wanted to briefly come back in on the social care SSI.
It was just really a point of clarification, just to say that although the powers have been used as a whole by local, only by four local authorities, they've actually been used less than that in terms of children's services. So some of the authorities that were using them for adult services are not using them for children's services. So to Rod's point, you know, about the majority of authorities are doing assessments as normal is correct.
I think it might be helpful to the committee and to Monica for David to amplify that in terms of the actual detail of the authorities and what they've been used for, because that just simply gets it out of the way. We then know definitively what the situation is. We're coming up to the end of a reporting period. We can either provide that separately or we'll put it into the report.
Thank you for that. Cabinet Secretary, I know your timetable is tight. There are two supplementary questions. I don't know if you have time to deal with them now.
Yes, of course. Yes, of course.
Firstly, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Convener. And Cabinet Secretary, thank you for your consideration about the overnight ferry from Aberdeen, to Aberdeen on the 27th. It actually raises another issue, though, about onward travel. So I wonder if I could have the opportunity to discuss that with your officials.
Of course. I mean, I think the implication is that if people are coming back on the overnight ferry, they would have to conclude their journey thereafter. So I think the implication is that that would be legitimate. But I just want to stress with you, I think that's I hope that's a good example of how we're listening to the committee and this new process is operating. But I do stress we must not have the 23rd and the 27th as tourist days. And the exceptions will be tight exceptions. So, but of course, let's try and provide you with more information if we can. And perhaps if you email me, we'll get somebody to talk to you.
Thank you. That's appreciated.
Thank you very much. The actual last question is from me in terms of the general travel restrictions, not the Christmas issues. And that is to ask how long the travel restrictions will last. I don't think there is a date in the regulations for it to end. So can you provide some clarification on that?
Well, I think they're intended to be part of the regulations for level 3 and level 4. So, you know, I would imagine, and I would just want to make sure of this, but I would imagine that they would last for areas within level 3 and 4 whilst they're in level 3 and 4. I don't think we're likely to change that at this stage. It could be that, you know, as and when the situation improves, then we relax those as part of the general process. But at the present moment, people should take it that if people are, you know, in level 3 and level 4, they should remain within the local authority area. And if they're in lower levels, they should not travel into higher levels. That is now for the foreseeable future.
Thank you very much. I now move to the third agenda item, which is consideration of the motion on the health protection coronavirus restrictions and requirements local level Scotland amendment number 2 regulating 2020 SSI 2020/374. Upon which the committee has previously taken evidence. This SSI gives effect to the changes in restrictions announced at the weekly review on Tuesday, the 10th of November. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any remarks on this SSI before we take the motion?
I think I've been happy to answer questions, so that's okay.
Can I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move the motion S5M23355 that the COVID-19 Committee recommends that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 2 Regulations 2020 SSI 2020/374 be approved?
Moved.
Does any member wish to speak on the motion? If so, could you please indicate this by typing R in the chat bar? I note that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S5M23355 be agreed to. Does any member disagree? And if so, please type N in the chat bar now. The motion is agreed to. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary this morning. Can I thank both the Cabinet Secretary and indeed all his officials for their evidence this morning. That concludes the public part of the meeting. We will now discuss agenda items 4 and 5 in private, and I invite members to change over to Microsoft Teams for the next part of the meeting, and we will reconvene there in 5 minutes' time. Thank you. I now suspend the meeting to allow that to happen in private.